Dear members of the Club de Madrid, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Berlin. I very much regret that I cannot be with you during these 2 days, but I am delighted to have this opportunity to welcome you per video and to wish you productive consultations and discussions. This year's annual policy dialogue has brought you to an interesting location, to Berlin. The traces of the major crises of the 20th century are more visible here than in almost any other city. Visitors are especially fascinated by sites which are firmly linked in our collective memory to the time of German division and the Iron Curtain. Checkpoint Charlie, the Brandenburg Gate, the Berlin Wall Memorial. All of these places remind us of the Cold War era when Berlin, Germany, Europe, and the world were divided into two blocks, into East and West. How infinitely happy and grateful we were, not only we Germans, when the wall fell in November 1989 and in the wake of the peaceful revolution in East Germany, a transformation began which changed the face of Europe and the world. Francis Fukuyama saw the end of history coming 30 years ago. A better world in which democracy and freedom would prevail seemed to be within reach. Today, however, we know that history did not end. At present, we see a world of converging crises. The COVID-19 pandemic continues to demand our attention. Supply chains have been permanently damaged, and this, along with rising prices on the energy markets, is placing a considerable burden on the global economy. Democracies see themselves challenged by autocrats, and despite the terrible experiences of the 20th century, a war is again being waged in Europe. The joint commitment to respect borders in Europe, which was laid down in the Charter of Paris in 1990, and which is an important element of European security architecture, has been trampled by Vladimir Putin and his aggressive expansionist policy. February 24th of this year, the start of the Russian attack on Ukraine marks a watershed, how our Chancellor called it. We are in no doubt about that. But what is the nature of this watershed? Is a new age dawning in which the world is again divided into blocks? Should our actions be determined once more by the old mindsets of the Cold War? In my view, certainly not, ladies and gentlemen. I firmly believe that we need global cooperation now more than ever. That is not just an option, but a vital necessity if we are to adequately address the consequences of climate change and assume responsibility for ourselves and for future generations. We have to confront this huge task, not as nation states or alliances of states, but as humankind. Returning to global rivalry among the major powers and to national interests, which are too narrowly defined, we cannot but fail to successfully tackle the task facing humanity. Our future lies in cooperation, not in confrontation. That is why we need strong multilateralism. What is more, we need political leaders who are committed to the idea of multilateralism and who can be heard engaging in the political discourses of our time with convincing arguments. The World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid provides such figures with an important forum to enter into a dialogue and strengthen the capacity of cooperation. As a member of the Club de Madrid, I know that this World Leadership Alliance can achieve much, both behind the scenes and in direct exchange with the current heads of state and government. It must keep on calling for resolute multilateral action, especially within the context of the United Nations. It is good that at the Alliance's initiative, so many sharp minds have come together to discuss what leading in a world of converging crises can mean. A successful leadership culture requires clearly defined objectives. The good news is that the United Nations 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development and the Paris Agreement of 2015 have already provided us with a joint framework for action with precise goals. Russia's war against Ukraine stands in dramatic contrast to the spirit and substance of these aims. Following the COVID-19 pandemic, it is another blow to the prosperous development of the global economy. It has caused increasing hunger and poverty in the world and is also a setback in the fight against climate change. However, the current difficulties and an increasing climate of national egoism must not lead to resignation. Rather, they should be an incentive to use the existing framework for global cooperation, that is to say, the United Nations, much more intensively than to date and to strengthen it. The fact that the United Nations itself was founded as a result of a poly crisis can encourage us to resist the temptation to stick our heads in the sand in the face of many crises at present and to work for a future marked by multilateralism. The current poly crisis can also spur us to look for partners and new alliances to tackle major challenges which we cannot resolve on our own. We should see each other in an unblinkered fashion. By we, I mean governments as well as representatives from the research community and civil society, companies and foundations. Despite all the conflicts in terms of interests, values and systems, it is more necessary than ever to argue for multilateralism, for a global conversation, also with those who are reluctant. It will not be easy to rebuild trust in interlocutors, but it is essential. The sometimes obvious path of dialogue is the only way out of the converging crises. And whoever seeks to find their way out of a crisis needs leaders who are as resolute as they are willing to engage in dialogue. The theme you have chosen for the annual policy dialogue is certainly both important and topical. I wish you a productive exchange of ideas. Mm-hmm.